So my name is Dwayne Coggins. I'm one of the cardiac electrical specialists here, cardiac electrophysiologist. So Matt and I, Dr. Levy and I, are both cardiologists, but we specialize in heart rhythm management. And so we don't do any general cardiology. Don't ask us any plumbing questions. We really don't know anything about that. But we love the cardiac electrical system and heart rhythm management. So that's what we'll talk a lot about tonight. We're going to focus primarily on one area of cardiac arrhythmias, atrial fibrillation. So what's the problem with a fib? First, it's often followed by another one. Second, it often makes you feel bad. But most important, fibbing can cause a stroke. Well, you think, well, what about fibbing? No, fibbing shouldn't cause a stroke, but AFib does. Atrial fibrillation is a rapid, irregular rhythm of the heart that is very common. The prevalence of this, it's an abnormal rhythm of the top chambers of the heart. Let me go back here a couple slides here. This thing is switching on itself. Okay. So atrial fibrillation is an abnormal rhythm of the top chambers, the atria. And the electrical rhythm is so rapid in those chambers, between 500 and 700 beats per minute, that the atrium is working very hard and very fast, but doesn't actually do any work, doesn't move blood. And that ends up being one of the consequences of the rhythm. So how common is atrial fibrillation? This is a graph that shows the U.S. population, and this is the age, you know, in decades, over time. You can see is, you know, 50s, 60s, the relative how many people in the U.S. are at the various different ages. And this is the prevalence of atrial fibrillation. You can see it starts somewhere in the third decade of life and gets most common when people are in their 60s and 70s. It's estimated that about 3 million people in the United States have atrial fibrillation as of 2009 when this was put together. And the estimate has been increasing in frequency, and it's estimated that up to double that, 6 million, will have that this problem by 2035. So what are its, why is it so important? Well, these are some of the reasons. If you have atrial fibrillation and it's untreated, there's about a 500% increased risk of having a stroke. It's one of the leading causes of stroke in the country. It also has a negative impact on quality of life because people often have poor exercise tolerance because their heart rates are too fast, or they're taking medications that then make them feel poorly, tired or fatigued or lightheaded, and limit their ability to do things. And finally, atrial fibrillation is very costly. It's estimated that about $12 billion annually are spent on this medical problem, just between admissions to the hospital for heart failure and for rapid rates, for cardioversions, for procedures related to it, for medications related to it. And this isn't even including lost productivity for people that are out of work. So what can we do? Well, going back to the basics, what happens in the heart? The heart is, we think of it as a pump. Its job is to move blood through the heart. But it does it by organizing the timing. The top chambers are the atria, right and left atria. The bottom chambers are the ventricles. And what keeps everything working right is the timing, the electrical system that's inside. Your heart has a native electrical system. You're born with that. You can take a heart out of the body or out of an animal, and it'll beat by itself. It doesn't need the nerves or anything else from the body. Your adrenaline system increases heart rate. Your vagus nerve from your brain can slow heart rate during sleep or at times when you don't need a fast rate. But the heart has its own intrinsic rate, and that's generated by a structure in the top of the right atrium called the sinoatrial node. And then the electrical wave spreads through the atrium like a pebble dropped in a still pond. The wave spreads throughout the atrium that way. And this is the P wave. The P wave is the electrical manifestation of the atrium firing. So that's when the top chambers fire. Next is the ventricles, which is the pump, the power chambers of the heart. When the ventricles fire, they inscribe a much larger electrical signal called the QRS. And that's when, right after that, blood is ejected from the heart. And so that's essentially the lub-dub of the heart. What happens in atrial fibrillation is the top chamber starts going at very rapid rates. Essentially, all the muscle of the atrium stops working together. It's a completely discoordinated or uncoordinated motion. So the heart's working very hard. The heart rate is actually 500 to 700 beats per minute. But since it's working so fast, moving so fast, and it's uncoordinated, it doesn't move blood. So how does that result in strokes? Well, if the atrium doesn't move blood, then blood can pool in certain parts of the atrium. If those clots then, or the pooled blood stagnates, it forms clots, and if clots come free, they can go out to your vascular system. 30% of your cardiac output goes right upstairs. So there's a 1 in 3 chance that a clot that comes out of your heart is going to go right to your brain. So what can we do? I mean, the important things that we can do, for the most important thing we do for treatment of atrial fibrillation is preventing a stroke. And we have very effective ways of doing that. The primary one is anticoagulation with warfarin. It's been the standard drug. There are now novel anticoagulants, new anticoagulant agents that are as effective as warfarin that are getting on the market. The other thing we can do is try to keep the person in normal rhythm, like either take medications or do some kind of procedure that allows us to restore normal rhythm. And that's the focus of Dr. Levy. We'll be talking a little bit more about catheter ablation. I'm going to cover some of the other things like anticoagulation. So there have been 5 large placebo-controlled trials, meaning that people were given either a placebo or anticoagulation. We looked at the effectiveness of warfarin in thinning the blood compared to placebo. These are large trials. There's over 25,000 people included in these trials, and all 5 of them were statistically significant. One of these trials was stopped prematurely because people were dying too often in the placebo group. So these had a very strong impact. They had over a 70% reduction in the incidence of stroke when compared to placebo. So these drugs work. Warfarin is a very effective drug. Here's the total of all the patients. It was an estimated 3,691 patient years saved with the use of warfarin. So a drug that works so effectively, it's so good, how effective are we as physicians and as a populace in getting that drug on board for people that need it? Well, it turns out that only about 55% of people, when you look at it does vary a little bit by age, but only about 55% of people that should be or have indications to be on warfarin are actually on the drug. And it's a mixture of different things, of course. Some people have lots of bleeding problems and can't get on the drug. Some people have never heard about it and don't get put on it by the physician. Some people ignore it. But there is a little bit of an education problem, both in the population as well as in the professional circles. I know when I was going through training, this was a number of years ago now, but going through training, we used to worry a lot about treating people over the age of 80 with warfarin because we worry that they might fall or have other bleeding problems. It turns out they have the highest risk of having a stroke and probably get the greatest benefit. So moving on away from now to restore normal rhythm out of the anticoagulation realm into using meds to try and prevent the rhythm, that's probably the best way to prevent strokes and problems with atrial fibrillation is just to keep the person in normal rhythm. And so this is a slide that shows how effective the best drugs that we have are in maintaining sinus rhythm. So this drug, amiodarone, here, you can see in about 12 months of follow-up, a person that started on amiodarone, only about 65 or 70% of people that take that drug are still in sinus rhythm at the end of 1 year. Other drugs, sotalol and propafenone, are also very effective agents. They're widely used around the country, have even a poor incidence, maybe 50% incidence at 1 year. And if you've already been on 2 drugs, what's the chances that a third drug is going to work? Very low, about 20% chance at the end of 1 year that you'll be in sinus rhythm if you've already tried 2 other drugs and your doctor tries a third one. So because of that, one of the things we looked for was what might we be able to do instead of medicines? Because medicines, clearly, although they work for some people, in general, they're not all that effective. And so one of the things that was found out is that atrial fibrillation, 95% of patients that have atrial fibrillation have the episodes originate from rapid firing right at the opening of the pulmonary veins. The pulmonary veins are structures that bring blood back from your lungs into the heart. So this is looking at the back of the atrium. This is three different hearts that have different kinds, different anatomic variations. So this is the most common. This is looking at the heart from the back, and just the left atrium. We've subtracted everything else away, the ventricles, the aorta, all the great vessels and everything like that. So this is just a reconstructed 3D scan, 3D CT scan. And this is the looking at the back of the atrium, the left upper pulmonary vein, the left lower pulmonary vein, meaning that the one vein that drains all the blood from your left upper lobe, and there's one coming from your left lower lobe, and likewise from the two lobes on the right side. So we know that these studies done by Miguel Hassinger out of Bordeaux showed that the atrial fibrillation originates from the transition when it changes from a pulmonary vein to atrial muscle. When it goes from venous tissue to atrial to muscle cardiac tissue, it's right at that border zone that atrial fibrillation is initiated. And this tissue, when it gets abnormal and starts to fire, it'll fire at very rapid rates. He documented rates between 300 and 700 beats per minute. This tissue firing at that kind of rate, just all hitting the heart and drives it into atrial fibrillation. So the idea behind that was, what might we do with an ablation procedure like this, where we go and we say, okay, well, if the site's coming from right here, what if I burn a circle around this, ablate the tissue around it, then we might be able to prevent that problem, eliminate the atrial fib problem from happening. And so this is just as a preliminary sort of lead into Dr. Levy's talk, showing the relative efficacy of catheter ablation versus best drug therapy. This is comparing a catheter ablation approach versus best drug therapy, looking at 1,080 months, which is essentially 3 years, or days rather, 1,080 days, which is essentially 3 years. You can see, as far as the ablation approach, about 80% of people can maintain sinus rhythm. That's not taking antiarrhythmic drugs, not having rhythm problems due to atrial fibrillation after 3 years. As opposed to best drug therapy, you can see there's a continual loss over 3 years, and that we're down around 50-55% after 3 years using the best drugs. So catheter ablation, if it works, you know, initially we lose about 20% in the beginning. But if it works, it seems to have good durability over time. So, a quick slide again, comparing best drugs, Sotalol and propafenone, to four different large trials with catheter ablation, where we're showing, again, somewhere between 75 and 80% efficacy over the first 12 months in these studies after getting catheter ablation. Other things you can do if you're worried you might have it, or have had some kind of therapy and wonder how effective the therapy's been, there's lots of choices now of ways to follow up atrial fibrillation, either to diagnose it or to follow up. This is a newly released device from Medtronic that's an implantable loop recorder. This device is, you can see hands that are the size of this thing. It's very small. And it can be effectively injected. You make a little tiny incision in the skin and then inject it underneath the skin, and it just sits there and can monitor your heart rate for 3 years. So it's got a battery that lasts 3 years, and you can program it to do two different things. One is it can just pick up rapid rates, slow rates, pauses, or irregular rhythms that it determines are atrial fibrillation, and it'll automatically record those. In addition, there's an activator that the patient is given that if you feel something, feel like your heart rate's irregular or rapid or something, you can push the button, it'll force a recording. It records 7 minutes before you push the button, locks that into memory, and then stores another 7 minutes afterwards. So you get a composite, a sort of a recording that lasts about 14 minutes around the time that you felt something. And then you can go get it downloaded, get the EKGs from that episode, and then look at exactly what happened and see what happened. And it gives us some of you may have had Holter monitor, which is a 24-hour monitor. We put a little thing on the belt, hook up electrodes to your chest, and then record every heartbeat you have over 24 hours. Well, 24 hours is fine, but that's not nearly as powerful as something like this that gives you 3 years of monitoring, and you don't have any electrodes on at all. The thing's just in there all the time monitoring your heart rate. So this has been a real advance, I think, for long-term monitoring. The other thing that's not only for diagnosis, but this is very effective for following people up. People that are on medicines, we think it's working, but this device would still give us a lot more information about the truth of that. Some people, when they get on medications, the rate, when you go into atrial fibrillation, the heart rate's relatively slow and the symptoms are not very prominent. You may be going in and out of atrial fibrillation and have risk of having a stroke or know that the drugs aren't really working, so they're not worth the side effects that they're causing. This kind of monitor would be able to let us know how effective drug therapy is. Likewise, it also gives us the ability to follow up after catheter ablation. So if this is put in after an ablation procedure and you're wondering how effective has that ablation procedure been over the subsequent 3 years, this would give us lots of feedback over that time period. So in addition, though, to devices that can be implanted, there are options out there for you, for the public. And this is an example of an app that's for an iPhone or an Android. It's called AliveCor. You buy this case for about $200 that can fit onto your iPhone. I don't know if it's made it to the iPhone 6 yet, but this is for an iPhone 5. So, and these are two electrodes around the case that are in the back. And so if you feel something, you could put this on your skin and you push the home button and it'll record an EKG. And a patient actually introduced this to me. And they said, well, I have this thing. I thought it was very suspicious about how good the quality is. But you can see, look at that. The fidelity of that tracing is terrific. I mean, if this is the quality of information you can get, and you bring that to your doctor, the power of that's incredible, right? What you've got from that is amazing. So and once you've paid the $200 and you own it for life. So you don't have to worry about 3 years, you've got it for the next 50, right? So this is a very effective way for you to be empowered and get information for yourself so that you can take data to your physician and help them make the right decision on your behalf. So in summary, what can you do about atrial fibrillation? Number one, and most important, is prevent strokes. If you have intermittent AFib or persistent atrial fibrillation, then you should be on blood thinners. And the reluctance to put people on blood thinners in the past has really probably been misplaced. Number two, you can stop the rhythm, and that's probably the most effective way to prevent stroke and other quality of life problems. You can either do that with drugs or ablation. And third, take control with home monitoring. If you're worried about something you might have, there are options out there for you that you could avail yourself of to figure out and get some data. And then you're going to have a lot more information to give to your doctor to let them evaluate what you have. So having said that, we've gone through that, I'm going to pass off the baton to Dr. Levy, who's going to talk about catheter ablation.
This subject is something that I think is an important subject. It's something that really, when you do this kind of training, you kind of learn about all arrhythmias, and there are different kinds of arrhythmias. But atrial fibrillation is such a huge problem. It's become such a huge part of our practice. And what's exciting and challenging about it is you have to adapt. There are people who train to do this. You have to keep on training to do it. It's a kind of a continuous process because the technology changes, the pharmacology changes, our understanding of the disease process changes, and so it really kind of forces you to really pay attention, to read the literature. It's a small little club, this electrophysiology community. We kind of know personally people all over the country. Dr. Coggins knows some of the real giants because he trained up at UCSF with Dr. Scheinman. So it's really fun and exciting and interesting, but you definitely have to kind of maintain your skill set. It's also hard adapting new technologies. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about atrial fibrillation ablation, which, again, I never realized how much of a part of my practice this was going to become. I mean, I kind of assumed it was going to be maybe 20, 30, 40%. I mean, it's 60% potentially of our practice, and it's because it's so common, and it's increasing as people age, and we're living longer, and the baby boomers are all in this age range where we're starting to see the arrhythmia. So again, in terms of treatment, and this is a kind of an area of some debate. There's some the thinking about this has evolved over time. Initially this ablation procedure in general was only for people it was a last resort because it seemed so invasive and so dangerous. But what's happened over time is these procedures have gotten so good and so safe. Atrial fibrillation is a very challenging ablation. And so, Dr. Coggins mentioned that the population is aging, the prevalence of atrial fibrillation is growing, and we need to kind of decide, well, how are we going to handle this problem? Who are we going to ablate? Who is a good candidate for ablation? And this has been changing. So again, we divide atrial fibrillation into several groups. One is paroxysmal or persistent, and then another group is permanent. And they put them in these nice little boxes, but really what it is it's an evolution. When you start with the arrhythmia, it just kind of comes and goes, and it's there for short periods of time. And then it becomes more tenacious until it's permanent. And permanent atrial fibrillation really is something that ablation is not well suited to treat. There's just too much change in the atrium to really effectively cure the arrhythmia. However, paroxysmal atrial fibrillation, or persistent, and what persist, I had a slide with this. I probably should have left it in my slide deck. Persistent just means that, you know, you're in it for longer periods of time, basically. You're not in it permanently because you can be shocked out of it or kept out of it with a drug, but without a shock or without a drug, you're just going to stay in it. So these groups of people are the people that are referred to Dr. Coggins and I for ablation. Now, if you don't have any symptoms, the guidelines say you thin their blood, you prevent strokes, and you control their heart rate. And I think people in our field are beginning to challenge this. At the same time, it's not wrong to treat these people conservatively. For example, if you have an 88-year-old who has no symptoms, feels fine, who's a very high-risk person for ablation, maybe you don't run headlong into an ablation procedure that has risk. Again, what is the game? What are we trying to achieve? We're trying to make people feel better. And if they already feel fine, what are we gaining? You take a 42-year-old person who's looking at another 40 years of being on blood thinners. Yes, they don't have symptoms, but that's not exactly the same. Number one, they're safer patient population. Number two, that's a long time to be on drugs that we know have a substantial amount of risk. So I would say that this is beginning to change. But clearly, people that have symptoms are the people that we really feel are appropriate for ablation. And when it says disabling, again, this is all in the eye of the beholder. Sometimes for someone who rides their mountain bike up and down, not being able to exercise is a disabling symptom. More common symptoms are shortness of breath, fatigue, dizziness, palpitations. But really, when it's getting in the way of you living your quality of life, you are a very reasonable candidate for the procedure. Again, hiding behind this circle, anticoagulation and rate control, antiarrhythmic drugs, and then last, catheter ablation, if antiarrhythmic drug treatment fails. Again, I would say that this is being challenged in the community, that we don't require, and nor do most insurances, require people to fail drugs. We'll typically do it, okay, because it's important to know, will this drug work? It gives people options. But I've only had one insurance that said, oh, no, you didn't try drugs. Go back and try drugs. Some people just don't want to be on drugs. Now, you saw this slide, Dr. Coggins' slide deck. Amiodarone, which is a drug I'm not sure any of you know about, has quite a lot of side effects associated with this drug. Sotalol, propafenone, are other antiarrhythmic drugs. And you see percent free of symptoms. This is kind of poor. I mean, you know, you're highly symptomatic and you're going to live. 50% of people are going to have to live with these debilitating symptoms. You know, I don't think that's appropriate. And yes, amiodarone does better, but there's a trade-off. There's a lot of side effects from the drug. So non-pharmacologic approaches, okay? I'm not going to spend too much time talking about pacemakers and severing the connection from the top and the bottom. It is a reasonable approach. Typically, it's reserved for the elderly, people that are felt to be too high risk for these other procedures, or perhaps this is their choice. But this is kind of a fallback. Surgical maze procedure, which is still done today, and then radiofrequency ablation. So again, I don't expect you to get all the information from these slides, but you know, this is a relatively new procedure. You know, the first successful Cox-Maze surgical procedure was performed in 1980. And what they actually did is they opened people's chests and they basically cut the atrium and sewed it back together. And what you get when you cut the atrium is you get a scar. Well, guess what? That scar is a barrier that doesn't allow current to pass beyond that scar. So if you kind of chop up the atrium into all these little pieces and sew it back together, it can't sustain the arrhythmia. It sounds barbaric, but this is what the initial Cox-Maze procedure was. Now, this has evolved, obviously. And Hassegger first kind of proposed a catheter-based procedure based on the surgical procedure. That's where we get the ablation from. The ablation started as a surgical technique, and what we've done is we've adapted the surgical technique, but instead of having to open up your chest, we can do it from a tiny little poke in your leg. There was a series of 9 patients in 1997. This is kind of the early days of the ablation procedure. And then a real important paper that came out, again by Hassegger, showing that most of the triggers that cause the arrhythmia come from these 4 veins on the left side of the heart, the pulmonary veins. And the way I kind of describe it, that if you have to have the trigger to start the arrhythmia. You have to have a spark to start the fire. If you don't have the trigger, then you don't have the arrhythmia. And that, and I'll come back to that and talk about it. So now we have these fancy catheter-based ablation techniques. We have fancy mapping systems that allow us to visualize the atrium in 3-dimensional space. Now we have a balloon catheter that freezes the left atrium, and these things continue to evolve. Cycle-phased RF catheters, thermocool, where we use a cooling technique to cool the tissue to allow us to deliver better powers. This is all since 1980. You know, so, and you can see that this wasn't really even being done in earnest that long ago. And so the field is just evolving rapidly. So one of the questions I get from almost everyone, what is radio frequency? Well, what radio frequency, the best way to describe it is it's current, okay? And what happens, for example, in a light bulb is current passes through the filament of the light bulb, and there's so much resistance in the filament that the filament glows. And if you touch a light bulb, you know it's hot. Well, guess what? That's what happens in the tissue. So the energy wave is delivered from the catheter, and the tissue is the filament. The tissue gets hot. It vibrates and gets hot. The tip of the catheter doesn't generate, it's not, if you took the catheter out and touched it, it's not hot. It gets hot because it's next to the tissue that's getting hot. But that's how radio frequency works. So what that allows us to do is in 3-dimensional space, it allows us to give a very precise burn. And what we're doing is we're taking out, destroying a small amount of tissue for the greater good. So we get thermal injury by heat conducted through the zone of resistive heating. It's the resistance that causes the burning. Now again, I mentioned earlier, these are other ablation procedures that we do. These are pretty good numbers. You know, not that long ago, if you had any one of these arrhythmias, many of which are quite common, you lived with it. Or you were on toxic drugs that made you feel crummy all the time, forever. 98, 99, 96, 97% cure forever. It's pretty impressive. This is a study from Frank Marshalensky. Granted, this is one of the best labs in America at University of Pennsylvania, but this is a collection of his data from 2000. And honestly, when I talk to patients and when I look at our data regarding these ablation procedures, our numbers are not terribly dissimilar to these numbers. Very rare do you have any stroke or death. In this series, there was 0. The big question is atrial fibrillation. How well do we do with atrial fibrillation? A much more challenging ablation. Dr. Coggan mentioned briefly that basically the ablation for the arrhythmia is designed and focused on these 4 veins. Remember, the triggers, we're trying to eliminate the triggers. If we know that most of the triggers come from these 4 veins and we create a barrier around these 4 veins, we've essentially eliminated the trigger for the arrhythmia. Again, this was the initial Hassegger study. It was only 45 patients. And this is what a trigger can look like. Dr. Coggins briefly showed normal rhythm. Here's a normal beat. And you can see right here that all of a sudden the heart rate gets real fast. This is a burst of 1, 2, 3, 4 beats from one of these veins. And you can see the numbers. But what we learned is that approximately 95% of the triggers that cause atrial fibrillation come from these veins. Again, another way to kind of show it, you have the triggers, extra beats, or other arrhythmias. That's what they look like. There's normal rhythm. There's the atrial early beats. And what happens? You have patients whose hearts are getting older, getting stiffer. There's changes in our hearts as we get older. The triggers cause the arrhythmia to happen in that patient population. And again, as I mentioned, again, this is not such an easy procedure. There's all kinds of technical difficulties with the procedure, and that's where a lot of the research regarding the procedure is. Patient's anatomy is completely different. You can't just go in there thinking, I mean, I can tell you, people that work in the lab, you know, we have these four veins. You come in, sometimes someone has three, and the one vein is a big vein, and it splits. Sometimes you have three on one side and two on the other side. So there's an amazing variability in patient anatomy. Remember, the heart is beating while we're doing this procedure. So the heart's beating, you know, vigorously during the procedure, and we're trying to be stable and keep our burn exactly on the spot we like it. Sometimes it's hard to get good contact with the catheters. We now have a catheter that can give us feedback about how good our contact is. You need to create a good burn. You know, we can touch that spot and put a little colored dot on there. That doesn't mean anything. We need to make a burn through the entire thickness of the atrium. And all these lesions, just like the chain link fence, they need to be connected. If you leave a gap in your line, the vein's not isolated. Again, I like the chain link fence. You got chain link fence, and one link is broken, the whole fence is broken. It doesn't matter if every other link in the fence was perfect. The fence is sitting there on the ground. Dr. Coggins showed this slide. This is Carlo Papone. And some of this early data was kind of scoffed at, laughed at, because it just was felt to be too good. And there may have been a little manipulation of the data. But what's happened over time is Dr. Papone's lab, Hasegger, Fred Moradi in Michigan, Frank Marshalensky in Penn, Andrea Natale, who's moved from Cleveland Clinic to Austin, and you see what's happening. These success rates just continue to kind of creep upward, and it continues to raise the bar in terms of the success and outcome of the procedure. And what we expect is, within the first year, somewhere between a 75 and 85% cure. And you know, when we say cure, again, remember, things are changing over time. We want symptoms to go away. So what's really critical is symptoms. Well, remember that little device that Dr. Coggins showed earlier? What's happening today is we're learning much more about the connection between symptoms and whether you're actually having the arrhythmia or not. But what's important in people who are symptomatic is making the symptoms go away. And that's really what we're trying to achieve with the procedure. In this day and age, I think Dr. Coggins and I have a higher standard. We want to see no arrhythmia. And we use this technology to prove and document that there's no arrhythmia, even if you are asymptomatic. Sometimes people respond to drugs when they didn't before. Again, you can conceive of someone who's completely debilitated by the arrhythmia. They're on one of the drugs and it doesn't work. And then you have the ablation procedure. And you still have the arrhythmia, but you go back on the same drug and no arrhythmia. That was considered in most of these trials to be a successful outcome. And again, I always tell people that it may require more than one procedure. That is not unusual. The complication rates for these procedures are very low. They're not zero. Okay, the most common complication is a perforation, where you actually poke a hole or burn a hole in the heart. And it's something that we recognize right away, and it's something that we all know how to treat right away, but it is a major complication, and in theory, you can die from something like that. So there are risks for the procedure, and these risks do increase as you age. We talked about some of the variability in anatomy, and this is kind of an MRA of the left atrium. And when I was in my training, this is kind of the original CARTO system, where you would use this mapping system. And at the time, this was like so cool. And it was just amazing that you could create this cartoon of the heart on the inside. And nowadays, I look at it and I laugh because it's just so silly looking. with these tubes and different colors, and it's just kind of silly looking. But we could do all kinds of things with this technology that we couldn't do before because we have this mapping system. You didn't have to step on x-ray and irradiate the patient and yourself. We could use this system and we could drive this catheter around in three-dimensional space using this map. So this is an old slide, but what I'm doing here is every time, this is the right atrium, every time I touch the heart, I can make a little white dot. And what this is it actually is step by step demonstrating how we build this map. So every single one of these white dots, I had to touch it with my catheter, accept the point, and you can see over time, anyone who knows the right atrium knows this is a pretty good looking right atrium. But you build this anatomy as you go. That's how we used to do it, and sometimes it would take us quite a while to build this anatomy. Well, then there was this big, huge advance. We could get a CAT scan and bring the image directly into the imaging system. We didn't have to use a cartoon anymore. This is the patient's real CAT scan imported into this mapping technology, and we could cut it in half and magnify it and go inside it and do whatever we want. Now, I mean, this is a real patient. Now what we have is a way of collecting this data just by moving the catheter around in the heart. And you might say, well, why is this any better than the actual anatomy? Well, you take someone's CAT scan on 2 or 3 days ago, and you take another image 2 or 3 days later, and there can be a dramatic difference in the size of and the dimensions of the atrium. What we're doing here is we're actually quickly creating the anatomy of the left atrium in real time, and it's accurate. It's incredibly accurate, and the volumes are correct, and this is real. I mean, I'm building it. This is like real time. So this is a procedure that used to take, that could take, you know, when you started, could take an hour. You got really good at it. It might take you half an hour to build the map. This is something that Dr. Coggins and I do now in like a couple minutes. And so remember, we're talking about eliminating the triggers. Okay, so these are the four pulmonary veins. Here's the two. I know it looks like a big blob, but here's the right upper, right lower, left upper, left lower. Again, this is a real case. You see this rim of red pebbles? What we've already done here is gone all the way around this vein, encircling it, creating a barrier of scar around it, and what have we done? We've eliminated the triggers from that vein. That's how we do the procedure. And what you see here I'm doing right now is I'm burning, and I'm working on this left lower vein. So you might ask, well, how do I know when I'm done? This catheter is called a lasso mapping catheter, and it has these electrical signals displayed here. So if I have a lasso catheter in the vein and I can record signals as I go all the way around it and I finish my circle, they all go away. Okay, because now I've created a wall between the normal atrium and the vein. So here, the reason why this catheter can record signals is the signal swoops into the vein. Well, if I've walled it off completely, no signals can get in there, and we know the instant we're done because the signals vanish. We also use intracardiac echo slide. It was really grainy, but what you see here is these are two veins: the left lower, and the left upper vein. And if you kind of use your imagination, you can see a circular object kind of hovering right at the mouth of this vein. This circular object is that lasso mapping catheter. We're able to look at the heart continuously throughout the entire procedure, and this echo image is another way to guide our ablation strategy. It also is a safety measure, right? If there's a complication or a problem, we know it right away. So here's the left superior pulmonary vein, and these, if I can just train your eye to this group of signals. Here's the EKG on the top, and this T10, down to T1, these signals are the signals recorded on that lasso mapping catheter. And see this wiggly line down here? So we're burning. And what you see here, what happens? Nothing, right? Here's the normal beat. Here's the normal beat happening in your heart. The top part of the heart is still beating, but what you've lost is the signal coming from the inside of the vein. So by going all the way around the vein, you've blocked it, you've isolated it. And if that was the vein that was causing the trouble, guess what? Problem solved, because now that vein is silenced. Sometimes you'll see these beats kind of fire off. You know that vein is blocked or isolated. Sometimes these signals will march on through, even though we know it's blocked. Now, this isn't the only technology that we have. We have high-frequency ultrasound and laser and cryoablation. And cryoablation is another system where we create block, but instead of using burning, we're using freezing. And you can see here there's a balloon. It's a balloon within a balloon, and it gets extremely cold. We snug it right up to the mouth of one of these veins, and we know we have a good seal by injecting contrast within the vein. You can see here on the echo image, here's the left lower vein. You see this rim? That's the balloon. And then we freeze. And I have this little animation that kind of shows you what we do. So we go up in the heart, cross over to the left side, put a wire in the vein, we inflate the balloon, and then we snug that balloon right up into the vein, and then we freeze. You know, anyone that's ever had been to the dermatologist knows that, you know, they can use freezing to destroy tissue as well as heat. And in some ways, freezing might be a safer way of destroying the tissue. So, again, just in summary, rate control is a reasonable thing to do for people that are asymptomatic. By simply putting people on a blood thinner, controlling their heart rate, and allowing them to remain in the arrhythmia is reasonable to do if you have no symptoms. However, if you have symptoms and you've either failed or you're intolerant to or you don't want to be on drugs, radiofrequency ablation or cryoablation is a safe and effective treatment option. And that's it.